Thanks, Dr. Upendra, for the kind and sweet introduction. Radiology without tears. What does the title actually mean? Going through the life of a resident is full of hard work, sleepless nights, and relentless studies. Over and above all this hard work and dedication throughout 3 years, one has to face the final exam, which can be very unforgiving, especially for the DNB students. The examiner is not at all going to be concerned about your tireless dedication and your devotion to the department or the tearful hard work that you have put in over the last 3 years. What matters the most? Actually, it is just your final performance in front of the examiners that is what matters. So friends, no more tears or fears for exams. You have the companion to support you with the smart way of sailing through the exam with flying colors. The objectives of this webinar is to first clear the clutter of unnecessary facts and knowledge from your mind, to target the practical exams with relevant knowledge, and to assist candidates, that is exam going PG students, in sailing through the exams at the very first attempt. Spotters, practical cases, and table viva are essential divisions of a practical examination. Of all these, table viva is the simplest and easiest to score. Table viva can be conducted at three or more stations, and the broad divisions can be conventional radiography, interventional radiography, barium and drugs, and viva on miscellaneous topics. In practical exams, there are generally four examiners. They can be five or three, but never less than three. Each examiner generally has a limited time, say about 10 minutes, for doing a comprehensive assessment of the candidate. In spite of different type of examiners and variable exam scenario, the spectrum of question which an examiner can offer is absolutely very, very limited. So what actually matters in the viva? Firstly, stable mind with mental peace and confidence is what matters the most. You must have a prior idea of what kind of questions are usually asked in the exam and have a prototype answer for them. It is very difficult to frame an answer instantly. Sometimes it is even difficult to recall the correct answer as the brain gets entangled in the clutter of so many facts and figures.
The list of table viva items seems to be endless, but in reality, the total number of questions and their single sentence answers doesn't even exceed a few hundred. Table viva is the most scoring portion of practical exams with the least effort. Interventional radiology table viva can start from simplest of the items like puncture needles or a three-way connector.
Satinder, let me just hold you a bit. I think there is some problem with the audio. Many people are raising this question. Let me just tell them. Please, I'll be putting up this in the chat box as well. If anyone of your friends have this problem, please tell them to select device audio. Okay, from the audio icon, which is at the lower part of your screen, which has been muted. Okay, so if you click that, you'll get an option, select device audio. You have to select that. Okay, if any of you are having a problem, please do that. Okay, and you can just inform your friends as well. I'm getting a few queries regarding that. And it's also there in the video that I had posted previously with the registration. That video had clearly had mentioned what all to be done. That's the reason that video was meant to be. Yeah, I think, Satinder, you can just continue. Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah, it's okay. The Vivon intervention can start from the very simplest of items like puncture needle or three-way connector and can extend up to angio seal or steps in doing arterial puncture or any interventional procedure. However, most of the viva is kept very basic. The interventional procedures are numerous. However, the basic steps are very easy to understand and they are must know for all the interventional procedures, whether you have seen them, assisted them with them or not. Contrast and drugs table. Again, the list seems to be very long, but in reality, just three or four of these items are asked from a candidate, and there are not more than 4 to 5 questions on these drugs or these tables, except for adrenaline, MRI, contrast media, iodinated contrast media. Rest all drugs have just 4 or 5 questions on them. We will discuss these drugs and all in a subsequent webinar. General VIVA topics include radiation protection, radiation effects, and these are indispensable facts about shielding, knowledge of regulatory bodies, and rules pertaining to practice of radiology. These are not just essential for VIVA, but for your practical, for your practice too. Few upcoming topics like impact of artificial intelligence and ELORA may also be asked. You should read about your thesis also. You must know at least about the aims and objectives, sample size, study duration, and method of biostatistical analysis employed in your thesis. So how the VIVA actually starts? Let's start with a VIVA scenario. Dr. Upinder, can you please share the video?
Yeah, I'll just do it for you.
What is this?
This one?
Yes, sir.
Sir, this is a grid, sir.
What is the use?
Sir, it is used to prevent scatter radiation.
Okay, what is the grid ratio?
Sir, grid ratio is the ratio of height of the lead foils and the distance between them.
What are the other types of grids?
Sir, grids can be linear grids, sir. They can be cross grids. There can be focus grids. There can be moving grids also.
Okay. What is the upper side?
Sir, I think this is the upper side, sir.
Okay. What do you use it?
Sir, we use this grid in radiography of thicker parts like chest radiograph lateral view, sir, and sometimes an abdomen x-rays lateral view.
Okay.
Should I play it again?
Yes.
I'll do that. I'll just stop share. I'll just play it once again so that everyone sees that video.
What is this?
So this one?
Yes, sir.
Sir, this is a grid, sir.
What is the use?
Sir, it is used to prevent scatter radiation.
Okay, what is the grid ratio?
Sir, grid ratio is the ratio of height of the lead foils and the distance between them.
What are the other types of grids?
Grids can be linear grids, sir. They can be cross grids. There can be focus grids. There can be moving grids also.
Okay, what is the upper side?
Sir, I think this is the upper side, sir.
Okay, what do you use it?
Sir, we use this grid in radiography of thicker parts like chest radiograph lateral view, sir, and sometimes an abdomen x-rays lateral view.
Okay.
Yes, Satinder, please continue.
Upinder, I believe there is some issue with the video. It's not displaying properly.
Yeah.
Anyways,
I
will just tell the audience what this was about.
Yeah.
So this was an exam scenario where a candidate was feeling so nervous and he is answering to the questions in a manner which makes the examiner very irritated. So we have another video, but I think that will also be having some technical difficulties. So at the end of the video, you must have felt that actually the candidate almost answered all the questions, but he was having lack of confidence and he was making so many involuntary movements. And he was also playing with the grid, which is not desirable. Whenever a grid is given to you, you don't have to say that it is a grid. You have to speak like this. You have to first read the label on the grid, what it mentions. It mentions the focal distance. It mentions the grid ratio. It also mentions the grid frequency and the type of spacer that is being used in the grid. The labels can vary from company to company, but more or less, many of the important information are available for display in the grid label. So actually, how should we start the viva? The viva should be like, sir, this is a focused type of radiographic grid with a grid ratio of 8:1. A grid consists of series of lead foil strips separated by a radiolucent spacer. The radiolucent spacer is made of aluminium or organic compound. Aluminium is preferred as it is structurally stronger.
Satinder,
the examiner has asked you one question and you have to answer whatever you can in one go. And you have to say all this so confidently that the examiner can feel your confidence and realize about the knowledge you possess about the material. He might not even ask you anything else on the radiographic grid and can start with some other material. So I start sharing my screen.
Yeah, do that. Or should I try video the second video again?
Yes, you can.
Yeah, I'll just do that so that we'll try this.
Sir, this is a.
So, can you people see?
It's still not so.
Radiographic grade of grid ratio 6:1 and a focal distance of 100 centimeters, which means it is a focused type of radiographic grid. Radiographic grid is made up of lead foils with an interspace between them, which is generally made of aluminium or organic compound. Aluminium is preferred as it gives more stability to the grid.
Okay, what is the unit?
Sir, grid firstly allows the primary radiation to pass, and secondly, it prevents the scatter radiation. Hence, it improves the image contrast and reduces the film fog.
Okay, what is the grid ratio?
Grid ratio is the ratio of height of the lead foils and the interspace between the lead foils.
Okay, what are the other types of grids?
So grids can be classified based on their arrangement or based on their movement, and also whether they are focused or not unfocused. Like based on their arrangements, they can be linear grids or cross grids. Based on their focus, they can be focused or unfocused grids. Based on their movement, they can be stationary grids, which are also known as lysome grids, or they can be moving grids, which are known as bucky.
Okay, what is the upper side?
Sir, this side is the upper side as it has got a linear marking on it. Also, the label is generally placed on the upper side of the grid.
Okay. Where do you use it?
We use it in radiography of thicker parts like chest radiograph lateral view and abdomen radiograph lateral view.
Yeah, that was the audio. I think most of them could hear the audio. We'll just pause on the videos in the end. We'll try to do some settings and we'll again try it in the end, and I can share you the videos with everyone. Okay. I'm sorry for that. Satinder, you can just share and continue.
So, this is how you're supposed to answer an exam. Now coming on to what is the upper side of a grid? Can you see the video, Upinder? Which is the upper side of the grid? So the answer has to be, sir, the labeled side is the upper side, and also there are markings on the upper side. There are generally one marking in cases of a linear grid and two markings in cases of a cross grid. The label over here has this information: the interspace material, the size, the grid, the lines, that is the grid frequency, the grid ratio, and the focal distance. So this information you need to read and tell the examiner there itself that you are aware of what all information is available on the grid label. This is the back side of the grid. It has got no lines, no grid labels on it. Next question, which can be shot at you, is how do you align the grid? So the center of the grid and the center of the cassette should align, and the long axis of the grid is generally always along the long axis of the table. Where do you use grid? Sir, we use grid in chest radiograph lateral view and abdomen radiograph lateral view. Grid should be theoretically used when the part thickness is more than 10 centimeters and the KVP used is more than 60 KV. However, for radiography of parts on X-ray table, there is an inbuilt bucky which is used to reduce the scatter radiation. Who discovered grid? It is very confusing sometimes. Actually, grid was discovered by Gustav Bucky, whereas the bucky was discovered by Potter. So you should remember, grid was discovered by Bucky and Bucky was discovered by Potter. So what are the other types of grids? You have to say like this: radiographic grids can be classified based on the pattern, their orientation, or their movement. Based on their pattern, they can be linear or cross. Based on their orientation, they can be parallel or focused. And based on their movement, they can be stationary or moving. A stationary grid, for example, lysome grid, and moving grids, which are also known as Bucky or Potter-Bucky grids. This is an image of a linear grid, linear arrangement of grid, and this is a cross arrangement of grid. Also, this is a focus grid. It is having a focal distance, and this is a parallel, that is unfocused grid or non-focus grid, and it is having an infinite focal distance. A focus linear grid will focus on a convergent line, whereas a focus cross grid will focus on a convergent point. Moving grid, also known as Potter-Bucky grids or simply Bucky, they were discovered by Potter. Remember this, because people do get confused. So what is the purpose of moving grids? These are set into motion, which can be one way or to and fro or oscillatory motion just before the X-ray exposure starts. And the intention is again to reduce the scatter radiation and also to reduce the shadows produced by the lead strips in the grid. The advantage is that it is very effective in reducing the scatter radiation. Whereas the disadvantage of increased patient dose, and it is prone for mechanical failure, and there is high cost factor. What are the parameters which are used to evaluate grid function? Remember this in the same order: primary transmission, contrast improvement factor, and Bucky factor. Why I have kept it in this order? Because see, primary transmission is the ratio of intensity with grid and intensity without grid. Similarly, contrast improvement factor is the ratio of contrast with grid and contrast without grid. They are very easy and similar looking. Now, contrast improvement factor is the best test because we want to get the best contrast out of the grid. Whereas Bucky factor is the ratio of incident radiation upon the transmitted radiation. It is a practical determinant of how much exposure factors we need to change while using the grid. and it denotes the ability of grid to absorb scatter radiation. What are the other parameters which can be used in a grid? Other parameters can be grid ratio, lead content of the grid, and grid frequency. A physics question: what causes scatter radiation? Sir, Compton scattering leads to scatter radiation, and the factors increasing scatter radiation are firstly the field size, the part thickness, and KBB. Field size is the most important and can be reduced by use of beam restrictors. Part thickness can be reduced, like in radiography of abdomen in obese patients, by use of abdominal compression bands. So remember, scatter radiation is maximum with high KBP techniques, large fields, and thicker parts. How do you choose a grid? Grids with higher grid ratio and lead content absorb more scatter radiation, which is desirable, and have highest contrast improvement factor. So high KB techniques, we have to high KB techniques, KBP more than 90, we have to use a 12:1 grid, and KBP less than 90, we have to use a 8:1 grid. What is an ideal grid? It can be asked to you. An ideal grid is a theoretical concept. An ideal grid allows all primary radiation to pass and still prevents all the scatter radiation. So in reality, the ideal grid does not exist. Next question is, if a focus grid is placed upside down, where the X-rays will pass? Now this question seems to be very easy, but this was asked to me in one of my practical exams. I knew the answer, but somehow the brain got locked and I had to pass this question on. So when you are not remembering or recalling an answer, it's always better to say, sorry sir, I forgot or I don't remember. Don't waste time in overthinking. However, the answer is, if a focus grid is placed upside down, the X-rays will only pass through the center. What are the other types of grid artifacts? Focus grids use upside down as in the previous case. There can be lateral decentering, which is most common, but it's not recognizable. Then there can be focus and distance decentering, which can be far focus decentering, near focus decentering, and combined decentering. This is a grid cutoff artifact due to lateral decentering. Now, why it is not recognizable? It is not recognizable because there is a uniform reduction in the intensity over the entire film, which can be assumed due to low exposure factors. Far focus and near focus decentering, just names are enough. Again, combined lateral decentering. You might get tempted to remember the effects of all of this decentering, but just avoid clutter. That's one of the objectives of this webinar. Just names are enough, because you go into that much of detail, you are likely to forget the thing which you want to answer in the exam. But yes, if you have completed your entire syllabus at least 5 times and you are left with nothing else to study, you are free to do so. What are the disadvantages of grid? Firstly, increase exposure factors and hence increase patient dose, and grid artifacts which can be caused by use of grids. There is something called grid cassette which can be asked to you. Actually, these are special type of cassettes used for portable radiography with a grid built into the front of the cassette. What are the other ways of reducing scatter radiation? Firstly, by use of beam restricting devices, reduction of part thickness, and then air gap technique. Have you ever used air gap technique? So what is it in reality? Actually, air gap technique is an alternative to the use of grid. If we are not having availability of grid, we can use air gap technique. Here, the OID, that is object image receptor distance, is increased and it creates an air gap between the object and the image receptor. In this, by moving away from the film, the amount of scatter radiation reaching the film is reduced, and thus there is improvement of contrast. Whereas the patient factors also need to be increased with use of air gap techniques, but overall exposure still remains as that compared with use of a grid. The only disadvantage with this is the use of low image sharpness. Now, this is a distinction question, generally not touched to anybody unless you are performing really well. What is grid frequency? So it is measured as lines per inch, and it is the number of lead strips per inch. And generally the value is 1.3 for line per inch is 5 for that 25 millimeter equal to inch. W that width of the entire space and lead strips. The cost of any material can be asked to you. You must be knowing the absorb the transmitted radiation and prevent the backscatter, and the locking system will always be on the back side of the cassette. Again, what is an ideal cassette? An ideal cassette should be light and weight, yet it should be robust enough to avoid routine wear and tear. The frame is generally made of aluminium to provide strength and yet to reduce the weight. Cleaning and maintenance of a cassette. That is, this is asked to many candidates and they are clueless about the cleaning methodology. Firstly, you have to say like this, sir, it is cleaned with a soft lint-free cloth using a mild detergent and an antistatic compound in a manner of linear fashion in a perpendicular lines. Dr. Upendra will be showing you a video how to clean a cassette at the end of this webinar. The cassette should never be closed after cleaning until it is absolutely dry. What are the other kinds of cassettes? There are single screen cassettes used in mammography. There are double screen cassettes used in general radiography. There are curved cassettes. They are used for views of mandible and maxilla in dental radiography. And also they can be used for intercondylar view of the knee. There are gridded cassettes. They have a grid in front, and they can be used in portable radiography or ward radiography. Again, about the cost. So you have to say, sir, a radiographic cassette of 14 by 17 inch size costs around 8,000 rupees per piece. So the cost is almost double as compared with the grid. Just remember like that. It also varies with the vendor. It can be asked, what are the common cassette sizes? The cassette sizes can be most common for chest radiography, 17, 14 inch size, 15, 12 inch size, 12, 10 inch size, and 10, 8 inch size. These are the four sizes you must always pick. The rest, three are up to you. And about the CR cassette. So how do you identify a CR cassette? In simple terms, you will always see a transparent plastic window and a barcode within it. That is because of the barcode of the eyepiece. And there is an imaging plate inside the CR cassette. If it is asked to you, what is this? So how you have to start? You have to say like this. This is a computerized radiographic cassette of 14 by 17 inch size, and CR cassette contains storage phosphors, imaging plates. Most of the CR cassettes have IP plate made with europium activated barium fluorohalides. Once exposed, there is a separate readout process using lasers within the CR reader, and the CR cassette is again ready for use. So you have to speak the entire thing in one go once the examiner asks what is CR cassette. What is the advantages of CR system? So there is a difference between CR system and DR system. Many of the hospitals use CR system where the workload is less, and large hospitals with a lot of workload use DR system. The CR system actually is a system of making your conventional radiography into digital radiography by use of a CR cassette, CR reader, and digital film printer. So a CR system is compatible with the existing X-ray machines. Your existing X-ray machines can be converted into a digital X-rays by use of a CR system. It has the advantage of portability, same as conventional cassettes. Also, any other advantage with the DICOM images, the repeat exposure is not required for over or under exposed images. The contrast and brightness of the images can be adjusted on the CR workstation. And also it provides advantage of permanent digital storage of the images. This is a very important question, spatial resolution of CR images. We often feel that there is a general mindset that the new technology will have a higher resolution. But in fact, the spatial resolution of CR cassette is only 5 to 8 line pair per millimeter, whereas the spatial resolution of conventional radiography is 10 to 15 line pair per millimeter. So how does it happen that we get a very clear image in digital radiography as compared with the conventional radiography? The overall diagnostic clarity is better with the CR system because of a high contrast resolution. This is how you need to answer. What is the material used in IP plate? So IP plates are made up of europium doped barium fluorohalides, or also you can say europium activated barium fluorohalides. They can also be made with thallium doped cesium iodide or gadolinium oxysulfide. If you can remember the last two, it's okay. Otherwise, europium activated barium fluorohalide is good enough. So what about the speed of CR system? There is something called speed of CR system. Speed of CR system is the ability of the CR reader to read the number of IPs per hour. That is 40 IP per hour, 50 IPs per hour, or 70 IPs per hour. And the cost of the CR system also increases accordingly. Also, the speed of CR reader varies with the IP size. The same CR reader, say Agfa or Fuji, Prima T2 or something, will have a higher reading speed for a smaller size of IP, that is 8x10 IP, as compared to a 17x14 IP. For example, say a 8x10 inch IP will have a higher speed for the same CR reader as compared to a 17x14 inch IP. Again, what is the cost? CR cassettes are very costly. Remember, it's around 10 to 15 times more costly than a normal cassette. So you have to say like this, a 17x14 inch CR cassette with imaging plate costs around 50,000, and it can vary with the vendor. And a CR cassette of Fuji will be compatible with CR reader of Fuji only, not with Carestream or any other vendor. Now again, this very old looking item, what is this is used for? This is actually, many people are clueless about it. So this is a radiography film hanger. So what are the other types of radiography film hanger? It can be channel type or it can be hanger type. So how you have to speak like about this? Sir, this is a channel type of radiography hanger. This is how we insert the film inside this channel type of film hanger. These are clip type of hangers. Now again, sometimes this item is kept on the Viva table and candidates are asked, what is it? So some candidates say, sir, it is a red light, which is quite shocking for the examiner. Actually, you have to say like this, sir, it is a safe light and it is a light source used for working in the dark room. It can be a direct type of safe light or that can be indirect type of safe light. So what is the purpose of safe light? Sir, it provides illumination only from the parts of the visible spectrum to which the phosphor is nearly or completely insensitive. Type of safe lights can be direct or indirect. A amber light is used for blue sensitive films and a red light is used for green sensitive films. Green sensitive films are also called as orthochromatic films. But if there is a film which is panchromatic, that is, it is sensitive to all the parts of the visible spectrum, then we need to have total darkness. So generally, that's why generally orthochromatic films are used and a red safe light is used. Now, another very important aspect of cassette, that is the intensifying screen. So intensifying screen are generally placed inside the cassette only, but you can also find them as a linear sheet of paper or lying on the viva table loosely. So it becomes confusing sometimes. This intensifying screen will be continued in our next webinar class. But however, I need to provide you some essential tips. Firstly, while holding the material during viva, don't start playing it with it because it irritates the examiner. You doesn't realize it because you are under so much of stress, but you are moving the material like you are playing with it. Only lift the item if you actually want to. Never lift the X-ray tube. It can get break. It's very heavy. It can break. Lift the item only if you want to. Or say, for example, if you want to see the grid label and all, lift the item. Observe it. Recognize it carefully. Read the label carefully. Start speaking automatically with confidence as much as you can. Because examiner doesn't like to ask questions and again and again to all the candidates. They get irritated by asking the similar questions, shooting again and again the same questions. So even if you're slightly wrong, the examiners help to help the candidate by course correction. You need to listen to the words of examiner very carefully. And the last but not the least, in fact, it is the most important. Never be adamant. Never be adamant. Okay, there is no way that you can defeat the examiner with your knowledge. There are brilliant students who doesn't find their roll number in the list of past candidates, losing it all just unnecessarily because of the wrong display of attitude. So you can never be more knowledgeable than the examiner, even if you actually are. Don't show that you are more knowledgeable and examiner is incorrect. My upcoming book, which provides one-stop solution to the list of all exam spotters, all the exam cases, with few prototype sample case discussion with answers. That is Radiology Without Tears, your passport to success for final radiology exams. It covers all the practical viva material, including conventional radiography, dark room processing, interventional material procedures, barium and procedures. Also, it provides system-wise list of all theory questions asked in DNB and the MD university exams over the last 15 years. There are a few sample theory answers also, which are commonly asked, like solitary pulmonary nodule, bone age estimation, etc. So why do we need such a book? Because there are infinite number of books in radiology, and this is the guiding theme of the book. Books are infinite in number and the time is short. The secret to success is to know what is essential, take it and achieve the best. Thanks a ton for your patience listening. Now Dr. Upender will be sharing a few videos regarding how to open a cassette, maintenance of a cassette, how a grid is placed.
Yeah,
let's Dr. Upender can take on.
Thank you so much, Dr. Satendra Raghuvanshi. It was a very unique way of having a class. Especially, I would have been very happy to have such a teacher would have told me. And this is exactly what happened during our post graduation. Our teachers were able to tell us these are the questions. They conducted many mock, and I thank Rahim sir and Sani sir for all those beautiful days that we had. And that is the inspiration I think Dr. Satendra is taking ahead while he is publishing this book. And thanks Satendra for the wonderful talk. I hope basically the audio and video, there was some problems. I'll try to share a few videos. Let's see if we can see that. Just give me a minute. I'll just do that for you. Are you people able to see this video? Yeah, this is exactly how to do loading of a cassette. Okay, I'll just replay this to you. So first thing, it should be on the front should be lower down. So okay, the And then we started from here. So see it again, how to load a cassette with the film. So we just open this and the front will have the cassette well. This is the cassette well. So with just using one, two fingers, you just place the film in the cassette and just close it and lock it. Yeah, exactly. And it is ready for you. So this is exactly, I have seen a few examiners asking the residents to load the cassette and show. So that's why this video. I hope everyone could see this. And I'll just show you the next video, that is how to unload a cassette, okay? And this is exactly how to unload, very similar. I'll just go back for you people. And just again, yeah, she just opened the keys and then important step, okay? You have to turn it on so that the front is facing towards you and this part, the front part had the well, cassette well. The film will fall on the posterior part. That is the back part of the cassette screen. So that is how it has to be, okay? So, and then you just take it with two fingers. So you have to ensure that it has come out of the cassette well. That's the way to unload it. And then one more thing, people may say that you need not entirely open the cassette. Okay, that the way we 180 degrees that we have shown here, you can always open it by 30 to 40 degrees. But I can tell you it's very difficult, especially as we are doing these things in the dark room. It's going to be a difficult task. So this is how to unload it. And we have a couple of more videos and I'll try and show the initial videos that Satyendra was talking about and he can come in and explain it again. And next we have, Satyendra was telling about cleaning the screens inside the cassette, okay? Again, open the cassette. Take a gauze soaked in a anti-static solution, which is usually provided. Yeah, this is exactly what he meant. You have to go linear, okay? Linear with the soaked gauze, very delicately. And then perpendicular to it, very important, okay? This is with the soaked gauze. And then take a dry gauze and try to wipe it off. Okay, again in the same manner, linear and perpendicular to it. Okay. So if the examiner asks you how to go about it, this is the way it is to be. And one more thing is we have to keep the cassette open till it is dried. Okay. So here it is closed. However, it needs to be kept open till it is dried. So we have one more video. How to carry a cassette. Okay, I've seen an examiner asking how to carry a cassette when you're doing this. So he has taken out the CR cassette exactly. This is the way, okay? It has to be between your arm and the body, as close to the body as possible and with the finger supporting the cassette. I'll just play it to you, play again for you, okay? Hold the cassette between the arm and the body supported by the fingers. Only one cassette to be taken at a time. That's very important. Okay, so why are we doing this? Just because the cassette and the screen both are very sensitive. Okay, especially the screen part is very sensitive. So that's the reason. And there is one more video which will just tell you where exactly is the stationary grid is placed. We all know a moving grid is placed underneath the table in front of the cassette. So many and the stationary grid may not be available so easily because we are having already a vertical buckies these days. But if you get and if you're asked where to place the grid, stationary grid in a vertical bucky. Okay? Grids are used both in horizontal and vertical buckies. So first he is placing the cassette. This is the vertical stand, not exactly a bucky. This is a vertical stand and this is the grid that is going to place in front of the cassette and lock it. Okay, so now it is ready for acquisition. So now the patient comes in and then position the patient and you can always, and it is ready for acquisition. Okay, this is exactly how to do, okay, how to place a. So Satyendra, I'll just show the initial videos, okay, of yours.
Yeah.
You can just tell me whether you're able to see it.
Okay.
You're able to see it?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yes, very well.
I'll just start it again. Are you people able to hear? I have just paused it.
Upendra, I think there is some issues with the audio. No problem. Okay. I'll just summarize it.
We'll share it with them.
Maybe or we can upload on the YouTube also.
I can hear the audio from the video.
Upendra?
Yeah.
Can I contribute?
Should I go ahead with the videos again?
No, not required. It's okay. I'll just summarize the video.
I'll play on again.
Just start the video, I'll show.
Yeah.
Thanks. Just look at the candidate. Actually, he is sort of very anxious. He is playing around with the grid, which is undesirable. This is, you should not sort of, you know, rotate the grid, play around with it so many times. It's not required. You have to be confident. You have to see the label in the first go and read the label carefully. Remember it if you can, or if you cannot, this you can read and speak. At least the examiner knows that where you are looking for, and you know where to look for what information. And once the examiner asks what is it, start answering in one go as much as you can, because examiners doesn't like to ask question again and again for very silly reasons. So don't rotate the grid and all the materials so many times. This is the take home message. And avoid your involuntary movements like lip smacking and all those. So avoid all those.
Should I tell the audience who is the student here?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Dr. Satendra himself enacting as a student just to create interest out of it. So we have a poll going on for all the audience. Okay, you can just participate before you leave this. Anyway, some people still have issues like videos and PPTs. They're not able to say. We will definitely share all the videos, PPT with you people on your email that you have given us, and we'll definitely try and share all those videos with you. Yeah, anyone wants to come on and give your inputs? Panyar Lat is here from Myanmar. Yeah, please, any inputs from your side? Yeah, just a minute. He has muted himself, so I'm not able to unmute him actually. Anyone else wants to come over the microphone? You can just unmute yourself and speak. Yeah, Satinder, thanks a ton for being a part of this journey, and you're a very extremely important part of our team. And thanks for sharing your knowledge with us. And we would love to see you again and again. And I'm sure that we will have many more classes on. And most importantly, your book that is going to come out, it will be useful for many people around here. All the residents who are undergoing training, as well as future residents, and they'll definitely benefit it. And I would recommend, it's one of the most sought after books currently for radiology residents. When is it going to be released? One of them has asked.
Maybe by end of February, it should be available on Amazon.
Okay, that's nice. And so that's it is. So the book will be most probably available by the end of this month. And Rahim sir, any comments from your side?
First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Satendra. It was a very well received lecture. It was very clear, concise, and to the point. Friends, we would like to have more classes from Dr. Satendra in the future. And nice to have such a great participation. That was the whole idea of our interaction. to learn and to improve and to share our knowledge with each other. Thank you everyone for such a wonderful participation. And
yeah, this is a wonderful, great class. Keep going.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. Anyone else wants to come over and give any feedback? And the poll is open. Please participate in the polls so that we get a feedback on that. And we'll very shortly come back with you to you with another class of ours, and definitely we'll be most probably catering to the exam going PGs again. It will be more of a exam related topics, and by Wednesday or Thursday I should be mailing you all anyone, and I would prefer that most of you can give your feedback also. You can give it by mail, email ID. You have my email ID, so you can just give a feedback on that as well. And thanks a ton. So we are ending this here for today. And thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much.